Hey, 42 here. You don't have to be a dentist to know that tooth decay is caused by the formation of plaque, which is basically a thin film of bacteria that coats your teeth. When you eat foods high in carbohydrates, that bacteria converts the carbs into acid, which erodes your tooth enamel over time. Fair enough. But what would you say to someone who instead believed dental decay was caused by tooth worms? Could you present compelling evidence of your fancy theory about plaque and bacteria that would convince them tooth worms don't really exist? And whilst we're on the subject, why do you believe in plaque and bacteria in the first place? Have you ever seen evidence for tooth decay with your own eyes? If not, how do you know the whole thing hasn't just been made up by dentists as a nice little money spinner? Teeth worms are a real thing, by the way. Or should I say, people thought they were a real thing for several thousand years. They're mentioned in ancient Babylonian and Chinese texts dating back to 1500 BC, with perhaps the most famous example being a cuneiform tablet with the excellent title, The Legend of the Worm, which recounts the heartwarming tale of a band of blood-drinking, root-eating worms that devour your teeth from the inside out. Why do I have a sudden urge to brush my teeth? Whether this belief came from actual worms in infected water, or the worm-like cylindrical structures that can be found inside the human teeth, we're not quite sure. But thankfully, science eventually came along and put this particular nightmare to bed. Tooth worms are just one of the many outdated scientific beliefs that we've since proven to be nonsense. For instance, these days most of us accept the Earth is a sphere. But how many of us have actually seen the evidence that it's true? Contrary to popular belief, the spherical nature of planet Earth has been a widely accepted fact for a good millennia or two now, having been discovered by Pythagoras and others as far back as the 5th or 6th century BC. The validity of the shape of the planet has been reinforced countless times over the years, whether by European explorers sailing around it or by NASA taking pictures of it from space. But despite that, the average, everyday person might have trouble pointing to any conclusive proof that shows them the spherical nature of the Earth. Like the cause of tooth decay, it's such a well-established fact that we simply don't question it. Or at least, most of us don't. Because now, a couple of millennia after we as a species generally agreed on what the Earth looks like, a growing number of people are rejecting established science and instead subscribing to the theory that the Earth is flat. So, strap yourselves in, because this is going to be one nonsensical ride. The Flat Earth movement can trace its roots back to English inventor, writer, and devout Christian Samuel Burley Robotham, who was born in 1816. It's no longer known exactly what prompted Robotham to reject a long-accepted fact concerning our fundamental understanding of the universe, but reject it he did. And with that strange kind of confidence reserved only for fools and madmen, he grew so confident in his Flat Earth theory, he decided he was going to prove it. His first test took place along the Old Bedford River, which confusingly is actually a canal, in 1838 in what's now known as the Bedford Level Experiment. The Old Bedford River ran through the Fens, a large flat coastal plain in Cambridgeshire, England. The slow-moving, man-made canal ran dead straight for several miles across flat ground, making it the perfect location to observe and measure any potential curvature of the Earth's surface. The first experiment was simple enough. Robotham put his body on the line for science by wading into the shallow, virtually stationary water and standing there with a telescope. He watched a boat with a flag on its mast 91 centimeters above the water row slowly away from him for nearly 10 kilometers, noting that the flag remained visible the whole time. Which was interesting because, according to Robotham's calculations, if the Earth really was curved, the boat should have been long out of sight by then. As we'll see later, there was a fatal flaw in Robotham's method here. But as far as he was concerned, he just scientifically proved that the Earth was flat. And his next job was to spread this message across the globe. I mean disc. In 1849, he published a 16-page pamphlet under the pseudonym Parallax, combining his findings with some carefully selected Bible verses to show, once and for all, that we live on a flat earth. He began promoting his views far and wide, although his debating skills in the early days weren't quite up to scratch. Two newspapers, the Blackburn Standard and the Preston Guardian, both reported how, during a lecture in Burnley, Robotham was questioned on why the hulls of large ships travelling away from shore disappeared before the sails did. It was a pretty good question, and Robotham was stumped. So stumped, in fact, that he paused for a moment, staring out across the audience as he waited in vain for inspiration to strike, and then legged it. But did this rather embarrassing setback put paid to Robotham's crusade or his pamphlet? Hell no! Instead, he doubled down, hastily penning some quasi-scientific rebuttals to this and many other counter-arguments to his theory, before coming out with a new and improved 221-page book titled Zetetic Astronomy, Earth Not a Globe. The use of zetetic here, a word meaning proceeding by inquiry, is laughably ironic. The same word is used more appropriately by paranormal skeptics, including the people behind the International Zetetic Challenge, which ran for 15 years and offered €200,000 to anyone who could conclusively prove that any paranormal phenomenon existed. People will do anything for money these days, but even so, the competition ended in 2002 with the prize unawarded. Having fled from a lecture hall when the going got tough, you might be thinking Robotham wasn't up to much when it came to debating, but it turns out, when your belief system is centered on something that almost every other individual on the planet thinks is absolute nonsense, you tend to get quite a bit of practice at arguing. And by the time his book hit the shelves, Robotham had matured into an accomplished debater and was filling lecture halls up and down the country, charging punters sixpence a head to hear him speak. He outwitted many opponents during this time through ingenuity and skill, which are both pretty essential when you've got no science on your side. But eventually, in 1864, a year before Zetetic Astronomy got its third, final, glorious 430-page edition, Robotham was tied down to another experiment. He was invited down to the Hoe in Plymouth, a large public space that looked out to sea, and asked to explain why a telescope set up there could only observe the top half of the lantern of the Eddystone Lighthouse, which sat 14 miles out to sea. Robotham, yet again, put his debating skills to good use, flying in the face of the observable evidence and claiming this actually proved the Earth was indeed flat. He most likely drew on arguments detailed in Perspective on the Sea, a section of his book that claimed a rough sea will affect which part of an object disappears as it moves further away from the shore. It was nonsense wrapped in a half-truth, but plenty of people present that day believed him. As much as it's easy to poke fun at Robotham and his flat earth fallacy, it's worth remembering he didn't have the benefit of the more obvious forms of evidence for a spherical earth that we have today. The first image of the earth taken from space was snapped more than 100 years after the Bedford Level experiment. And this was also some 65 years before the invention of the aeroplane, meaning world travel was far, far trickier than it is today. That bit's important because one of the easiest ways to demonstrate the Earth is spherical in everyday life is to hop on a plane to the opposite hemisphere to the one you live in and look up at the night sky, which will be full of constellations not visible from your home. But even putting all of that to one side, let's not forget Robotham was under the impression he had scientifically proven the Earth was flat. So what exactly did he get wrong then? To find out, we can look at an open challenge put forward by one of Robotham's followers, John Hampton, in the weekly journal Scientific Opinion. Hampton's confidence in a flat earth was so unshakable, he was prepared to offer £500 to anyone who could prove otherwise. That's about £60,000 in today's money. It was a bold claim, but you have to wonder if Hampton was just a tad nervous when none other than Alfred Russel Wallace took up the wager. Wallace was a naturalist, explorer, geographer, anthropologist, and biologist who is most famous today for having co-discovered the theory of evolution, alongside Charles Darwin. Well, I say famous, most people have never actually heard of him, but he put pen to paper on his own evolutionary theory in 1855, 4 years before On the Origin of Species was written. And in many ways, the theory of evolution is as much his as it is Darwin's. Anyway, suffice to say that in Alfred Wallace, John Hampton had more than met his match. Wallace had even started out his career as a surveyor, so as well as being one of the leading thinkers of his generation, he also happened to know a thing or two about taking measurements in real-world settings. As it turned out, it wasn't that Rowbotham's findings were wrong, exactly. He had indeed taken accurate measurements of distant objects that shouldn't have been invisible to him had the Earth been spherical. The trouble was, he'd failed to take into account one crucial factor in his experiments: atmospheric refraction. To see why this was kind of a big deal, let's imagine someone standing on a giant salt flat, shining a torch directly in front of them, so that the beam is level with the ground at their feet. If the Earth was spherical, you would expect the ground to slowly curve away from the beam of light, which would continue traveling straight off into space. You would expect that, but it isn't quite what you'd actually see. That's because as our beam of light gets further away from the ground below, the atmosphere becomes less dense. As you know, the speed of light changes depending on the medium it's passing through. And as the density of the atmosphere decreases, the speed of light traveling through it increases, causing the beam of light to bend due to refraction. Depending on the atmospheric conditions at the time, that bend can be pronounced enough that it roughly matches the curvature of the Earth, which means that to someone standing at the other end of that giant salt flat, it could appear as though the torch is being shined directly at them, when in reality it's pointing way over their head. To put it simply, Rowbotham was tricked by an optical illusion. Most of you will have seen this effect in action before, by the way, because it's also what causes mirages. On very hot days, air near the ground can get significantly hotter, and therefore less dense than the air above it, inverting the pressure gradient that affected the Bedford Level experiment and causing light to refract in the opposite direction. Not with the curvature of the Earth, but away from it. When you see these shimmering patches on the road on a hot day that look like puddles, you're actually seeing patches of sky that appear from your perspective to be below the horizon, thanks to the bending of light from atmospheric refraction. And the same goes for lost and thirsty travelers in the desert. It isn't their desiccated minds playing tricks on them at all. It's physics. Anyway, our friend Alfred Russel Wallace was a clever chap and knew all of this, and so he made a few tweaks to the experiment to correct for refraction, including setting up his telescope much higher above the water than Rowbotham had. As was to be expected, the now accurate experiment demonstrated what we all know to be true today, that the surface of the Earth is curved. An independent judge brought in to adjudicate the wager was satisfied enough to declare Wallace the victor. But Hampton refused to accept defeat, going so far as to write letters to every publication he could think of, accusing Wallace of cheating, and even sending a threatening letter to his wife. The two ended up in a long-running court battle, and although Wallace won multiple libel suits against Hampton, his legal fees ended up costing him a small fortune. He would go on to consider taking up the wager to be one of the biggest mistakes of his life. In a strange twist of fate, Wallace, quasher of early flat earth theories, would go on to be something of a pioneer in another nonsensical movement based on conspiracy theories and half-truths, anti-vaxxing. But that's a story for another time. Despite the fact Wallace won the bet, the flat earth theory simply wouldn't go away. 20 years after Rowbotham's death, Lady Elizabeth Ann Blount took up the Flat Earth mantle, hiring a photographer to capture the results of her own poorly designed version of the Bedford Level experiment, which once again ignored atmospheric refraction in favour of promoting the Flat Earth theory. Lady Blount, an equally zealous Christian who used her social standing to further her views, helped found the Universal Zetetic Society that would later become the Flat Earth Society. Blount carried on spreading the message that had begun with Robotham, while she and others continued to develop theories for all things Flat Earth. After all, this was a society founded on reasoned inquiry, so they were going to need some compelling, believable, and provable explanations as to where humanity's best thinkers had been going wrong all these years, right? Nah. Now, fair warning, some of the following might sound somewhat illogical and inconsistent. That's because it is, obviously. But still, brace yourself for bullshit. It turns out there is actually no unified Flat Earth theory, more a collection of carefully conceived absurdities, each more ridiculous than the last. Let's take a look at them, shall we? As the great prophet Robotham himself taught us in his work, Earth Not a Globe, we all live on a flat disc, with the North Pole at its centre and a 45-metre high ice wall, aka Antarctica, around the edge. You know, to stop everything from falling off. Now, if the Earth is just a big pancake, certain changes have to be made to other well-established facts. Trivial things like gravity. The theory of gravitation makes perfect sense if we're all on a large spherical mass, but it makes no sense at all if the Earth is flat. Luckily, flat earthers have come through for us on this one as well with a different explanation. And by different, I of course mean the kind of nonsense you might see scrawled on the wall of an 18th century mental asylum in human feces. Instead of gravity, flat earthers hold that the planet is actually accelerating upwards at 9.8 meters per second squared, which neatly matches gravitational acceleration. What's below the Earth pushing us upwards and causing this acceleration? Dark energy seems to be the general consensus, which is pretty convenient since even real scientists don't know what that is. How exactly the Earth can continually accelerate upwards without either crashing into something or eventually exceeding the speed of light is, as yet, unknown. Then we have the Sun, Moon, and the other planets. Oddly enough, flat earthers are happy to admit all of these are spheres, albeit ones that are far smaller and closer than traditional science would have us believe. For instance, both the Sun and the Moon are just 51 kilometers in diameter and sit about 4,800 kilometers above us, and the Sun apparently just sort of dances around like a giant spotlight, illuminating the flat Earth below. Perhaps the strangest thing about all of this is that despite its quite obvious absurdity, the Flat Earth movement is actually gaining traction in the modern world, even as our understanding of the universe continues to grow. This may seem counterintuitive, but given the movement's origins, the rejection of scientific evidence in favour of a very literal interpretation of the Bible, it's perhaps not that surprising. The internet has made it far easier to share information, and more importantly, misinformation, and the resurgence of evangelical churches in many countries has furthered the beliefs. In Brazil, where evangelical Christianity is rampant, there are estimated to be 11 million believers in flat earth theories. That's 7% of the population. Another factor is the enduring popularity of conspiracy theories. Roughly half of the US population believes in at least one conspiracy theory. From the government planning 9/11 to aeroplane vapor trails containing chemicals as part of some vague plan to control the weather or manipulate human psychology. It seems people find the allure of secret operations and worldwide cover-ups too hard to resist. Speaking of worldwide cover-ups, that might just be the most baffling part of Flat Earth philosophy, because a prerequisite of believing the idea of a Flat Earth is also believing that countless individuals, organizations, and governments in every country on the planet are working together to propagate the greatest lie in history. Chief amongst these enemies of truth, according to flat earthers, is NASA, which, for obvious reasons, is public enemy number one. Those damned evil astronauts are said to be working with the world's elite ruling class, with powerful governments, the Illuminati, the Rothschilds and the Rockefellers. According to many flat earthers, the higher ups at NASA aren't actually all that worried about the shape of the Earth, they're merely concerned with covering their own backs. You see, flat earthers are convinced space travel is the real lie, that we've never been into space and the moon landings were faked. Pictures of a round Earth are simply created that way because NASA thinks it looks kind of cool. But since neither they, nor anyone else, has actually ever been into space, what do they know? Without space travel to occupy themselves, NASA staff are simply a bunch of scammers trying to keep their funding coming in. Their duties mainly include manning the giant ice wall encircling the entire planet to make sure no one gets too close and falls off the edge of the world. And of course, their resident Photoshop whiz spends his days faking photographs from space to pretend they've been there. The thing is, believing the truth is being hushed up isn't just a prerequisite for being a flat earther. It's one of their greatest weapons against people who say otherwise. Because whenever some piece of evidence or reasoning comes along that doesn't quite jive with the whole flat earth thingy, they can just cry conspiracy. Lee McIntyre, a philosopher at Boston University who actively seeks out science deniers to understand their behaviour, attended the 2018 Flat Earth International Conference in an attempt to better understand the kind of people who would be taken in by such a fringe belief. McIntyre asked one of the conference's guest speakers if flying over Antarctica without having to refuel would convince him the Earth was spherical. Remember, flat earthers believe Antarctica to be a giant ring of ice encircling the world that's tens of thousands of miles long instead of just a few thousand. So if the flat earthers are correct, it should require a refuel to get around it. At first, the man agreed. But then his conspiracy instinct kicked in, and he suggested that maybe the entire history of aviation had been set up, controlled, and doctored to make us believe that planes need to refuel far more often than they actually do, when in actual fact they can get anywhere in the world on a single tank of fuel. Basically, he saw his ideology was under threat, so he played the C card. This kind of reasoning is why ardent flat earthers are nigh on impossible to shake from their views. Looking at the evidence objectively, there would be no way anyone could believe in a flat earth. So to get around that, flat earthers are just careful never to let themselves get too objective. The conspiracy even extends to other flat earthers in some kind of bizarre science denial turf war. So-called modern flat earthers, for whom the Flat Earth International Conference is the premier event of the year, want nothing to do with the Flat Earth Society that can trace its roots back to Robotham in the 1800s. They instead believe the Earth is inside a kind of giant snow globe, onto which the sun, moon, and stars are affixed, like an enormous version of the Truman Show. And just to really confuse things, they believe the Flat Earth Society is simply another government-controlled body who are in on the whole conspiracy with the aim of spreading ridiculous theories that discredit the real, perfectly sensible Flat Earth movement. You really couldn't make this stuff up, could you? So, there you have it. A brief history of one of the most nonsensical, backwards, and downright ridiculous conspiracy theories on planet Earth, one that somehow gains more believers every day. You might be wondering what drives them all to this collective madness. I've mentioned that to many, it's about wanting to believe in a very literal translation of the Bible, but the funny thing is, nowhere in the Bible does it actually explicitly state the Earth is flat. One of the most common excerpts quoted by flat earthers comes from Isaiah, which refers to God sitting on his throne above the circle of the Earth. A disc is certainly circular, sure, but then again, so is a sphere when seen from above. Ultimately, I think it comes down to something I'm going to call matrix syndrome. People just want to believe in the red pill, that they're amongst a small number of enlightened people who truly understand the world and that everyone else is a globalist sheep that's too much a part of the machine to question it. Don't get me wrong, there are certainly occasions in this age of mass media when that is the case, but when it comes to believing the world is actually a giant disc surrounded by an ice wall, well, we should all take care not to be so open-minded that our brains fall out. Thanks for watching. You can now buy my new book, Stick a Flag in It, on Amazon, or get the audiobook on Audible. You'll find a link to both in the description below. Thank you.